அகன் சதீஷ் நல்ல போல் இருக்க
சார் ஒரு ஃபியூ மினிட்ஸ் வெயிட் பண்ணலாம் சார்
நல்ல போல் இருக்க
சார் ஒரு ஃபியூ மினிட்ஸ் வெயிட் பண்ணலாம் சார்
நல்ல போல் இருக்க
சார் ஒரு ஃபியூ மினிட்ஸ் வெயிட் பண்ணலாம் சார்
சதீஷ் சார் குட் மார்னிங்
குட் மார்னிங் கணிக்கிறேன் சார் ஆடியோ கரெக்டாக இருக்கா சார்
சதீஷ் சார் குட் மார்னிங்
குட் மார்னிங் குட் மார்னிங் மே ஆடிபிள்
கணிக்கிறேன் எஸ் எஸ் சதீஷ் சார் குட் மார்னிங்
குட் மார்னிங் குட் மார்னிங் சார் குட் மார்னிங் ஹாய் சார்
எஸ் எஸ்
Good morning sir
Sharma good morning Rajesh sir good morning
good morning
good morning good morning sir good morning 41.92. Latch index is 19. Item index is 62. It's a fellow member in many societies. In six bodies, fellow of Zoological Society of India, fellow of Society of Sciences, fellow of Advanced Zoological Research, fellow of Society of Biology, Biocontrol, Biotech, and fellow of National Academy of Biological Sciences. And about his service, teaching service, he joined as a lecturer in 1992 in Arulanandar College of Karmatur, Paramia. Then he shifted to Kamaraj College of Tuticorin from 1993 to 1994. And then 1994 from 98 Celsius College. Then 1994 to 1998 Zen Joseph College. And from 1998 till date, he is working as a professor in St. Xavier's College. So he has a very long service of around 30 years. And the most significant achievement is possessing two patents. And his contribution to the academy as a resource person for Board of Studies, examiner, PhD, examination in universities and colleges around 20. And he has 17 academic orientation programs. He had been assigned many administrative responsibilities in the institution, like a head, dean, research cell member, UGPG planning, board and additional grant member, UGC plans, college management committee, curriculum development cell, planning and evaluation committee, college governing body, examination committee, IQC member, academic council member, screening, college council, secretary of the college council, overall coordinator for the STAR scheme by DPT. So he served for the institution in many, many ways. He is a well-trained person in molecular techniques, and for the journal publications also he contributed as a editorial board member for 8 journals and associate editor in 10 journals and reviewer for 12 journals. He is a member for more than 26 bodies, and we visited many countries like Austria, China, etc. His research grant around 1 crore and 72 lakhs, a huge amount we got from various agencies like IIHC, DST, CSIR, IFS, MOES, etc. And some financial assistance received from other agencies like about 12.43 lakhs. He has organized this seminar, around 4 seminars, 4 chair conferences, 13. And delivered a guest lecture around 44. His publications in the reputed journals, international and national journals, crossed 180. He presented papers in conferences, as coming around 77, and published chapters in the book about 22. And he published books around 6. And under his guidance, 19 students awarded a PhD and 5 students ongoing. And he has guided 25 MPhil scholars. So this is going on like this. So today really we have an eminent personality to grace our webinar, international webinar. I must thank him for his acceptance to share his expertise to us. And really, we, all the participants, get benefited from his expertise. So thank you and welcome you, sir, for this international webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sadesh, for your nice introduction. Thank you. First of all, I congratulate the Department of Martinez and Joseph's College for conducting a webinar for 4 days continuously, yesterday, today, and we have 2 more sessions in the forthcoming days. I thank the organizers, Dr. K. Rajan, the organizing secretary, and also the co-organizing secretary, Dr. S. Anusia, for conducting this 4 days webinar. So I am very happy to share some of my findings and also many findings related to the pest management. The content of my lecture includes the population, the food production, constraint in the pest management, overview of biopesticides, bio-nanomaterials in the pest management, particularly the defoliator management, sucking pest management, and the storage pest management. And also I cover some aspects related to the phytopathogen management. And lastly, your clarifications. So if you refer this website, worldpopulationreview.com, as of 22nd June, the population is 7.79 billion. The contribution of China is 18.47%, whereas the Indian population contributes 17.70%. They also focused the population in 2050, it is focused 9.77 billion. So the population is gradually increasing, but the land, available land for the cultivation is same. Sometime it may be decreased due to our activities like the industrialization, and we are occupying for the plots for the for residency. Though the population, the land level is same or also decreasing, the food production, considering the food production of India, in 96 to 99, it is about 98 million tons of food produced. It increased nearly 71 million tons during the census of 2015 to 2018. So within the limited source, that is the land availability, we are producing more amount of food because of the advancement of technology. Though the plants faced many constraints like the biotic factors and the abiotic factors. The biotic factors includes the flood, famine, and other aspects. Abiotic factors mainly includes the pest population. The pest is nothing but an organism, starting with the microbes to the human being. It disturbs or it reduce the production of the crop. It is considered as a pest, starting with the microorganisms like the fungi, algae, viruses, and to the mammals, higher animals, the mammals. And there are 5 categories. The pests are 5 categories. Some pests are present throughout the year. Say, for example, the thrips. They are present throughout the year in the plants. And secondly, some pests are not frequently present in the, frequently present in the land. Say, for example, the butterfly, citrus butterfly and the aphid. The aphid is considered as a pest of most of the plants, cultivable and non-cultivable, including the forests. The third category is occasional pests. It is not a frequent pest, but it has some kind of association with the particular plant. Say, for example, the scale insects. It's a very common pest in most of the plants. The fourth category is the seasonal pest. So we may come across this kind of pest like the teak defoliator. It present only immediately after the rainfall, only seasonal. We may come across this kind of pest in the crop particularly like the teak and other forest trees. The last category is sporadic pests. It is infrequently and isolated condition they are present in the plants as a pest status. Say for example, this is a butterfly. We may come across this butterfly in sometimes. So the pest is common in the most of the cultivable and non-cultivable plants, and we have to know whether it is a pest or the natural enemy. So the before we undergone into the management practice, first we have to take the census of the pests. Okay, then next we have to take their damaging situations. Based on this decision, we will go for the management practice. So in the olden days, people used chemicals, particularly DDT, BHC, dieldrin, aldrin. Recent days, we have been using the synthetic pyrethroids. Tell me, sir. Okay, sir. Okay. And during 1970s, scientists introduced a concept called as the IPM, Integrated Pest Management, where we are integrated many pest management components like the mechanical control, biological control, chemical control, the cultural control, and the other practices. So we got some good results because of the introduction of the IPM. And recently, in 2000, scientists introduced another concepts, namely the BIPM. It is Bio-Intensive Integrated Pest Management, where biological based components are introduced in more amount instead of the chemicals and other pest management components. Considering the bio-intensive integrated pest management components, biopesticide is considered as one of the important, vital, prominent pest management component, where we incorporated plant-based insecticides, microbes-based insecticides, semiochemicals and other chemicals. Most of them are biological based chemicals. More than 4,000 plants were screened for the pesticidal activity. However, prominently we have been utilizing very few plants like the neem, Asaridacta indica. India and other countries produce enormous commercial product from this plant. So there are some limitations for the availability of the biopesticides. Since the nanotechnology is a very prominent, widely accepted by many people, now the biological based nanomaterial has been introduced in the pest management field. Considering the biopesticides, we had some publications. It is listed in the here. I told you we have to first look into the pest population, identify the population. So after the identification of the population, we have to look into their damage level. If there is no damage, if there is no loss, damage and the loss, then there is no need of adapting pest management. If somehow the loss, we observe some kind of loss, then we don't worry about the loss, product loss or the produce loss. If the loss goes above the particular level, it is considered as the economic threshold level. Economic injury level, that is related to the damage, and the economic threshold level is considered as the loss. So if it is going beyond the particular level, then we will go for the pest management. Otherwise, it is not necessary to go for any pest management options for the particular plants. I will tell you about the ETL for each and every pest in the forthcoming slides. Coming to the biological nanomaterials, I told you the living organisms, their products are bioactive principle, or even the precursors of the bioactive principle have been utilized for the production of nanomaterial, that is the bio nanomaterial. So it is spelled, or it can be used as biosynthesis. Some people using this word. Some people using the biogeny, biogenic, biomimetic, biogenesis, green synthesis, biomineralization. So you can use any word, any one of them. All of them are synonymous words. So you can use any one of these words for the bio nanomaterials. Actually, it's a cross-disciplinary subjects involving biologists, the chemistry people, the physics people, and the engineering people. So all the people are involved in this field. Not only the biologist, they should integrate this subject. You have to collaborate with other scientists from the botany. You have to collaborate with the chemistry. You have to collaborate with the physics and even with the engineering science people. Then only we will get the very good results and publications from your research. There are three steps involved in the preparation of the material, bio nanomaterial. One is the metal, selection of metal and selection of solvents. That is first component, followed by the biological material. It is act as both reducing agent and stabilizing agent, reducing as well as stabilizing agent. So if it is reduced, then the biological material is capping around the nano metal or metallic ions. So when it is capped with the biological material, then it should be stabilized at least for 6 months, a minimum or 3 months. Because if you purchase any kind of synthetic insecticide from the industries or from the market, it should be stable at least for 6 months. Such a kind of character can also be expected for the bio nanomaterials. So I have listed out some of the metals and metal ions, starting with the silver, platinum, gold, the copper, selenium, bismuth, indium, palladium, lithium. However, most of the Indian publication mainly focusing on either silver or the gold. Coming to the second and the third aspects, that is the reducing agent and the stabilizing agent. So for the stabilizing and reducing agent, we can use microorganism like the bacteria, yeast, fungus, algae, viruses. And we can also use the plant materials, both terrestrial and aquatic plant materials. Various parts of the plant materials like the leaf, stem, bark, flowers, fruits, seeds, latex, even bulb can also be used as a reducing and stabilizing material. Most of the drug delivery researchers, they used the animal cell culture, cell lines. Some of the animal products like the saliva, egg albumin, the bovine serum albumin, hemoglobin, heparin have also been used by many scientists for the reducing and stabilizing agent. Honey has also been utilized by few publications. In addition, some of the enzymes have also been utilized for the reducing and stabilizing agent. Recently, DNA, RNAs, cellulose, chitin, and chitosan, collagen, silk have also been utilized as a reducing and stabilizing agent. Few examples for your understanding. So, I have been working with the bio nanomaterial since from 2009. So far we produced nearly 18 bio nanomaterial by using the marine algae, by using the terrestrial plants, few examples of marine algae like the Alva lactuca, Alva faecietta, Calarpa varolensis, Calarpa scapuliformis, the Lophophora variegata, Sargassum whitey, Badania pavanica, and we also use some of the terrestrial plants like the Pongamia, Vernonia. So in addition to the plants, many scientists used the bioactive principle like the ascorbic acids, azadirachtin, the nimbin, solanin, citric acids, geraniol like chemicals. They are all the having potential pesticidal value. So I have been focused related to the pest management. A simple methodology is first we have to prepare the, say for example, the silver nano means we have to prepare the aqueous solutions. We can prepare the plant materials whether either by using the water or DMSO or using the solvents. Then you have to mix it in a correct proportion. Then we will get to the dark brown color material for the silver. So this color change plays a very vital role for the preliminary screening or preliminary characterization or preliminary preparation of nanomaterial. That is the call it as the plasma resonance, changing of color from its original color. A few examples, say for example the garlic, a different time interval, different dosage, we prepared the garlics, and by using the avarambu, scientists prepared. So the color change, gradual color change. Copper, it gives the dark green color and also gives the golden color for the copper. Gold gives the dark red color for the gold. And for the microorganisms, either the mat or the cultural colonies can be used, or the broth can be used for the preparation of the nanomaterials. Few examples: Aspergillus, Trichophyton, Microsporum. They can also use the Klebsiella. This is for the gold, selenium, the palladium. So this is a preliminary preparation of the nanomaterials. So I would like to highlight a few points about the identification of the bio-nanomaterials, starting with the preliminary confirmation. If your college or if your lab contain the UV spectrophotometer, then you can start work with the bio-nanomaterial without any hesitation. So most of the colleges, laboratories are having the UV visible spectrophotometer. So you can start work with the bio-nanomaterials. So this is a preliminary observation for the gold. The maximum absorption maximum between the 380 to 450. For the gold, 525 to 540. This is our results. The nanomaterial was synthesized by using the Calarpa scapuliformis. We characterized all the characterization we carried out. We published these findings in 2012. This is for the Calarpa varolensis. The size of the nanomaterial is very important. The size and shape of the nanomaterial is very important. This is a characterization. This is for the Padania pavanica. This is for the Pongamia glabra. This is for the Vernonia cinerea. And characterization, XRD is very prominent instrumentation. We can find out the metal, because the metal or metal ions have been used for the synthesis. So the identification of metal. So after the synthesis, we have to identify whether the metal is present in the synthesis material or not. So the XRD plays a very vital role. And similarly, the metal can be detected by using the EDS, Energy Dispersive X-ray Spectroscopy. And another instrumentation, FTIR. So most of the colleges, the Joseph's College, also having the FTIR, we identify some of the material in the central instrumentation center of the St. Joseph's College. So the, I told you the stabilizing and reducing agents. So there is some of the bioactive principle or act as a stabilizing and reducing agents. So the group can be identified by using the FTIR, functional group. And the surface, sometime it may be spherical, sometime they are oval, sometime they are very plain. So the surface features are identified by using the X-ray photoelectronic spectroscopy and also using the attenuated total reflectance Fourier transformation infrared. And the image, the shape can be shape, size have been recorded or identified by using both the SEM and the TEB. In addition to the TEB, we can also use the particle size analyzer to know the particle size of the nanomaterials. The shape and the size also can be find out with the help of atomic force microscopy. So this is a very preliminary, where in a nutshell I explain about the characterization of the bio nanomaterials. So once it is characterized by using sophisticated instrumentations, so most of the instrumentation not available in most of our colleges, mostly it is available in IIT like the institutions, research institutions. So we have to pay and identify the nanomaterials. So it may cost about the 2,000 to 3,000. If you are ready to spend 2,000 to 3,000 rupees, then you can go for the bio nanomaterials. The bio nanomaterials not only utilized for the pest management, it has lot of biological value. So okay, so you have to take some kind of research related to the bio nanomaterials. So in this talk I am mainly concentrating within pest management, because we are all depends upon the, for our livelihood we depends upon the food. Our crop is mainly destroyed by, affected by the pest, particularly the insects, So if you spray the liquid bio nanomaterials, so we can prepare in emulsion, we can prepare in capsule, encapsulated form, we can prepare in the sphere, nanosphere. Okay, so the three forms is widely used in the agriculture field, agriculture industry, for the pest management. So if you spray the liquid emulsion over the plant with the help of the sprayer, then what happens? So it may be falling on the plants, it may be falling on the insects, it may be falling on any kind of organisms present in the plant. And most of the spray is drifting on the soil. It was recorded nearly 99% of the spray is falling on the soil. The remaining 1% only falling on the plants and also the insects. So if it is spraying on the plant, it may be all the parts, it may be possibilities all the parts, maybe it may in the leaf or through the stomata, it may be enter into the leaf. So if it is present in the soil, there are a lot of possibility to enter into the plant, as like the fertilizers and other minerals and other materials. The nanomaterials also entering into the plant through the root hairs and other parts, root cap like parts, it may be enter into the plants and separated into various parts of the plants. Okay. The first I would like to introduce this pest, the Helicobacter paramitiana, American bollworm, commonly called as the American bollworm. And the X, here you can see the X This is a larvae, this is a pupae, and the adult. So it's a very common pest in India. It's a very common pest in India, and most of the Asian country we may come across this Helicorpa armigera. And another pest related to this Helicorpa armigera is Helicorpa zea, is another pest. Even in Tamil Nadu, the zea is present in the maize field. So there are a lot of similarity between the Helicorpa armigera and the Helicorpa zea in the structural manner. So it affects the Helicorpa armigera, affect almost all the food plants, vegetables, and the other plants. Particularly, they affect the cotton, tomato, maize, sorghum, the chickpea, pea GNP, pulses, vegetables, tomato, almost all the plants. A single larvae is enough to damage 30 to 40 bowls. And the fruit of the cotton is called as the boll. So it causes lot of injury or infestation into the cotton. The ETL, economic threshold level. So if you come across a single mass of egg in a plant is enough to cause the economic threshold level. So when we go for the census or the various pest present in the plant, if you come across one mass of egg is present in the one plant is enough, then we suggest to the farmers to go for the pest management. Okay, or even if you come across one larvae in a plant is enough, it may affect the production level of the cotton. So these are the few chemicals has been utilized for the pest management. So previously there are two sprays recommended by the pest management practitioners, people or extension worker, for the management of Helicorpa armigera in the cotton. Now in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, people have been using 4 spray or even 5 spray, even 6 spray. Even then, it is not possible to manage the Helicorpa armigera and other pests in the cotton field. So many farmers are committing suicide because of this pest. Okay, so it has lot of the economic value and also social value. This pest is having social value and economic value. Moreover, this pest developed resistance against many common insecticides worldwide. So the scientists are opting go for alternative methods like the bio-nanomaterial for the management of Helicorpa armigera. It is coming under the biopesticide. So there's a publications related to Eporphia, the Amman Pachar say, I think, the crude extract of the Eporphia prepared and it is mixed with the silver nano solutions. As the way we prepared the liquid silver nano Eporphia materials. Eporphia based silver nano liquid materials. And the cotton leaves are dipped into the liquid materials and provided to the first insta, second insta, third insta, fourth and fifth insta, and sixth insta, and find out the mortality of the insects. The mortality of the insects is very high in the later stages. Say for example, in the sixth insta, the mortality is 80% when we compare to the Euphorbia leaf extract. Similarly, in the fifth insta also, the mortality is high. But in the early instars, like the second instar and the third instar, the mortality of the nanomaterial is low, but statistically it is not low. Statistically, both Euphorbia plant extract as well as the nanomaterials are almost the same. 85 and 84 gives the statistically insignificant value. So the we can use the nanomaterials as one of the components in the pest management. So I compared this value. I compared this value with the already available publications like the azorodactin. So I told you the worldwide azorodactin is the only biopesticide marketed by many companies. So the azorodactin needs nearly 4.8 days
to kill 50% of the helicobacter armigera. But this results says the 15 star more than 80% mortality was recorded in within four days. So the commercial product is less potency than the nanomaterials. Similarly, the BT cotton has been introduced in India for the management, pest management. So the BT needs 3.6 days to cause 50% mortality of Helicobacter armigera. But the nanomaterials, it causes more mortality. So we can utilize instead of the commercial product as well as the BT product. Okay. So in addition to the mortality, it also reduces the growth rate. So the normal growth is reduced, and pupation rate, the pupation rate is enhanced. So some hormones, the growth hormones, are induced by the nanomaterials. As a result, it may be enhanced, and the pupation rate is enhanced, but the adult longevity is reduced. Normally, the male and females lives around 9 days, but it is reduced to 2.32, 3.7 days. So within the 3.7 days, it is not possible to reproduce. So the reproduction rate is arrested. So it is recommended to use the nanomaterials based on the 4B plant. And another nanomaterial available for the Helicobacter armigera control is the Trichoderma viridi. It's a biofertilizer. Fertilizer has been utilized for many plants. So this Trichoderma viridi based liquid broth has been utilized for the preparation of titanium nanomaterials. Okay. So this titanium nanomaterial based on the Trichoderma viridi, it has larvicidal value, it causes mortality in the larva, it affects the feeding of the larvae, and it also shows the pupicide. So in the Lepidoptera, it is a Lepidoptera, Helicobacter armigera is a Lepidoptera insect. So it has 4 stages, namely the egg, larva, pupa and adult. And this tested nanomaterial showing impact against larva, pupa. So it is a very good results, very good findings. So in the first instar, it causes 100% mortality. In the second instar also causes 100% mortality. Whereas in the third instar, it causes only 92% mortality. Okay. So the it has a potential value, insecticidal value. So in addition to the insecticidal mortality, either to the larvae or the pupa, and the basic mechanism behind the insecticidal activity is the presence, increase and decrease of detoxification enzyme. If any xenobiotics enter into our body, so the immediate action of our body is to produce the detoxification enzymes. In addition, it also produces antibodies. Okay. But in insects, in addition to the cellular immunity, like the production of the antibody, it also produces the enzymes like the glucoside, carboxylase, and the important vital detoxification enzyme is glutathione S-transferase. So this is another mechanism. Coming to the next important insect is Podoptera litora. So this is the tobacco caterpillar. It is called as the tobacco caterpillar. It present in the Asian countries, Australia and Pacific Island, in the Indian continent, the Asian. It synonymous to the Spodoptera litora is Spodoptera litoralis. It is a synonymous insect. Some scientists are saying both of them are same. Some scientists are saying it's a biotype of the Spodoptera litora. So it is mainly present in Germany, Russian Federation, UK Union parts. So this pest affects more than 120 insects, particularly the cotton, groundnut, maize, rice, soybean, tea, tobacco, like plants, it causes damage. And it consumes nearly 85% of the leaf area. And the yield is considered as 29%. And the ETL is presence of 8 egg masses. So this is the egg mass. So it lay the eggs in groups. So immediately after laying the eggs, it covers the eggs with the some hairy material. It's a kind of the parental care. It's a kind of parental care. So if you come across 8 egg masses in 100 meter squared or the meter row area, so the in the field we may have the row and the the plants are the most of the cotton, the groundnut, the maize are planted in rows. So in the 100 meter row, if you come across 8 egg masses, then you can advise to follow the pest management concepts. Otherwise, it is not necessary to follow the pest management concepts. So this is the larva, Spodoptera littoral larva. This is the adult. The gold nanomaterials. The gold nanomaterial. Gold is prepared by stirring method, and you have to add the trisodium citrate dehydrate. So then we will get the sodium nano materials. Sodium nanomaterials or sodium nanoparticles. This is intact with, it is tagged with this material. Sodium nanoparticle is tagged with DNA. The commercial available half thymus DNA sodium salt solutions. So we will get the DNA tagged gold nanoparticles. So this gold nanoparticle is incorporated into the synthetic media diet, synthetic diet. So in under laboratory condition, it is possible to culture the Spodoptera littorea in enormous number or in the mass culture manner. We go to provide the synthetic medium, synthetic artificial medium. So what the author did is, along with the synthetic diet, they incorporated the DNA tagged gold nanoparticle in various proportions like 200, 300, 400 and 500 ppm. And it is provided to the various stages, third instar, fourth instar, fifth instar, Spodoptera littorea larvae, and find out the mortality. So in insecticidal value, the lethal concentration 50 is a very important statistical tool to express the impact of any materials. So in the third instar, 645 ppm necessary to kill 50% of the third instar larvae. It is reduced to fourth instar and further reduced to fifth instar larvae. Because it is matured larvae, it need less amount of the material, bionano material, to kill the fifth instar larvae. So actually in the theoretical value, whenever we grow, we need more amount of the synobiotics to kill. But here unfortunately this finding says the fifth instar larvae need less amount of nanomaterials and the fourth instar larvae needs the more amount of nanomaterials. So it may be due to the little amount of nanomaterial is enough to interfere with the pathways, various physiological pathways to intervene the pathways, to intervene the digestive system and cause the mortality. So it is compared with the already available literature. Say for example, the one of the insecticide and the chlorpenazepam. Chlorpenazepam is a pesticide. The LC50 value is 12 nanogram to kill the 50% of the fifth instar larvae. But here you see 256 ppm is enough to kill this Spodoptera littorea larvae. So the theoretically as well as the practically, it is more potent than the synthetic insecticides. This is the graphical representation of the third, fourth and fifth instar larvae mortality related to the various concentration of the nanomaterials. So in addition to that, it also causes lot of deformities. So you can see the larvae is intact larvae. It emits lot of pellets, fecal pellets. Even the bursting out of the digestive system, the oozing out of the body fluid. So similarly, the another photograph. So I think it is intervene with the midgut causes a lot of damage in the epithelial cells present in the midgut region and causes the bursting of the larvae. As a result, it causes the death. Another important insect is the Spodoptera thuringiidae. So it is an important pest in not only in Asian countries, it also in UK, US and the other countries like the Brazil and China. It's a very important pest. It affects most of the corn. So in foreign countries, maize, corn are the most important food plants. So they causes nearly the very heavy loss, 9 to 62.5% loss. Okay, so it's considered as a very important pest in the other countries like the UK, US, Brazil like countries. So the ETL is 5 to 6 egg larvae. So previously I told you the even 8 larvae in the row of 100 meter for the ETL of the Spodoptera littura. But the thuringiidae, it is only 5 to 6 egg masses. This is the photograph showing the various stages of the Spodoptera thuringiidae. Here I told you the nanocapsule and nanosphere in the beginning. The nanomaterials are available in three forms, namely liquid, the emulsion, capsules and the sphere, nanosphere. The capsule nothing but the capsules, the capsule which we have been consuming for the various diseases. So the capsules are made up of polymeric layer coated commercial product. So this commercial polymeric form is filled with nanomaterials which is synthesized by using the neem seed kernel extract, neem oil and the polymeric poly alpha and beta hydrobutyrate PHB. So these materials are incorporated into filled into the nano capsules and released into the field level. So instead of spraying, instead of mixing into the water, it is the capsular form is the easiest method in foreign countries they have been following to pest management. So the capsules are placed in the field. So slowly the capsule emit the materials. Sometimes it is mixed with the sand materials, sand, and when the water is irrigated, it is entered into the root and through the root hairs and other parts, it is entered throughout the plant parts. So it gives some kind of resistance to the insects. If the Spodoptera littura is feeding on this plant, it deter or it may cause the mortality. So the result is not adaptable one in the future, because if it is given in the organic material, neem, the powder, or in the organic liquid material, it causes 100% mortality. If it is given in the powder form, encapsulation form, and it gives the 75% mortality. But compared to the nanomaterials, the mortality is very less. So it is not practicable, and it needs a lot of further researches to go into the next step. Though it give the less mortality, in the body weight increase, is also not much interested results, So they almost the same, the body weight of the water, the control and the nanomaterial incorporated capsule are almost same, statistically almost the same. But the powder, organic powder, and the gives only 9 milligram. So this organic material, organic neem material is recommended for the management. And another important pest of the rice throughout the Asia is Chilo suppressalis. Okay, the suppressalis is a very good, very destructive pest of the rice throughout the Asian countries. It causes a lot of losses. So if it is enter into the stem and it affects the shoot of the stem and causes the white head, The symptom is called it as white head. For the economic threshold level, if you come across 25% and the dead hearts or the white head symptom, then we will go for the management practice. Otherwise, it is not necessary to go for the management practice. So, in addition to the white head or the dead heart symptom, it also affects the inflorescence. As a result, the crop yield is by the Kylo. It is recommended to use many options like the bio-nano materials. So, one of the important component of the pest management practice is the cytochrome P450. So, it acts as a xenobiotics. This is cytochrome P550 is acts as xenobiotics. Both in endogenous manner as well as the exogenous manner. It intervenes or it mimic with the hormones, and it mimic the steroidal hormones, and it also combine with the fatty materials and show its impact. If it is acts as an exogenous manner, it's a appropriate pesticide. It acts as an appropriate pesticide, and also it acts as a phytotoxin, toxic to the plant materials. So most of the scientists are not recommending because of it is a phytotoxic to the plant materials. So instead of using the cytochrome as such in the commercial product, it can be modified as encapsulation form. So this encapsulation double strand RNA materials. So the cytochrome is combined with double strand RNA materials, and it is encapsulated and utilized for the Kylo suppressalis management. And the important mechanism behind the pesticidal activity of the capsule is it intervenes with the combined with the nucleus materials present both in the gut, the midgut region, and also combines with many hemocytes, the blood cells of the insect present in the midgut region. So I told you it affects the midgut region and causes the physiological metabolic changes in the digestive system. As a result, it shows the insecticidal value. So it mainly present in the foregut region. So another important insect is the common pest of the tomato. Common pest of the tomato. Okay. So Mysa trifolia. It is common in America. So in America, the most of the vegetables, particularly the tomato, is damaged by this pest. 20 to 30% of the damage is may caused by this insects. So the economic threshold level, even two larvae is enough to cause the economic threshold level. Then the entomologist suggested to practice the pest management. So for this management, titanium dioxide nanoparticle has been used by using two stabilizing and capping agent like the citronella grasses and the tea tree. Both oil has been used for the preparation of titanium dioxide nanoparticles. So the people emergence, I told you in the Lepidopteran insects there are four stages, namely egg, larva, pupa and the adult. So the larva is transformed into the pupa. That process is called it as the pupation. Larva is transformed into pupa, pupation. So the pupation is impact of the titanium is tested in two manner, namely the choice test and the non-choice test. Choice test means there are different choices of food is given to the insects. Say for example, the normal, and one is incorporated with the grass and another one is incorporated with the tea tree and another food materials. Lot of choices are given to the insects to feed. In the non-choice, only the particular nanomaterial incorporated leaf is given to the insects. So two ways the testers are tested: free choice test and the no choice test. So in the no choice test showed more impact, because there is only choice is the provided food in the laboratory condition. So it shows more impact. The preparation is highly reduced. 95% of preparation is reduced, and the titanium 95%, and the tree incorporated it is the 82%. Similarly, in the adult emergence, it also reduced by the tree grass incorporated and the citronella incorporated. It is about 79% and 82%. So if the titanium alone sprayed food is given, it is only 72%. So in addition to the pupation rate and the adult emergence, the others also recorded the egg period, that is the incubation period. So the incubation period in the free choice and the no choice test also affected by the both tree as well as the citronella incorporated the titanium particles. So this is a common pest, Pericalia racini. This is our publication, Pericalia racini. It is common in India as well as in Sri Lanka, particularly the castor, gingerly, cotton, beans, banana, sunflower, maize and brinja. So it's a very common pest present in our cultivation land. What they're doing is they scraped out almost all the chlorophyll content of the leaf. So the plant is not unable to go for the photosynthesis because there is no chlorophyll in the leaf. This is the way it causes damage to the plants. Even two larvae is enough. Two larvae in the square meter is enough to cause the damage. Or 10% of the insect population, Pericalia racini population in the field is enough to go for the economic threshold level. Otherwise, it is not recommended, advisable to go for the pest management. So nowadays, if you come across two pest, three pest, even below the economic threshold level, economic injury level, our farmers are immediately, they spray the pesticide without knowing the concept, the entomologists, the agriculture people, scientists should go regularly to the field, village field level, and train them, teach them to the farmers about the all these aspects. Then only they can learn lot of things, the modern things and recent findings about in the science and technology. They may be follow for the reduction of the pesticide spray in their field. Okay. We synthesize nanomaterial by using the pongamia oil. So it's easy emulsifiable concentration. So the preparation of emulsifiable concentration liquid is very easy. We use both gold and silver nano particles and prepared the emulsifiable concentrations. Okay. This emulsifiable concentration, we incorporated some stabilizing agent, and we incorporated stabilizing agent and the spreading agents like the 280 is usually act as a spreading agent. If you have not incorporated any spreading agent, then it is not entered into the plant. So this is about the mortality. The silver, gold causes more mortality. The gold causes more mortality, 60% mortality. And the pungam oil causes 53% mortality. This is the Vijayaneem. Vijayaneem is the commercial product, neem-based commercial product. Most of our farmers have been utilizing this product in the pest management. So if you compare with the Vijay Neem, the synthetic commercial product, the gold nanoparticle gives more results, okay, more mortality. So automatically it is advisable to utilize the bungam oil incorporated the nano materials for the pericalia resini mortality. So it the bungam oil incorporated insects and the weight, body weight is also minimum 268 milligram per animal. This is about the emergence, people emergence and adult emergence. So the either the nanomaterials alone or incorporated EC gives the very good results to reduce the pupation rate as well as adult emergence. So this can be utilized. This it's a pungam oil is very cheaper, normally available one, locally available one. So we can utilize this kind of product for the nanomaterial preparation. Okay, so we can go for the commercial product also. We can go for the commercial product, patentable one. It's a patentable one. So already, since already we published this material, it is not possible to go for the patenting. This is the Spodoptolitra, Kylo, Pericalia resini, Helicorpa, they are all called as the defoliator. They feed the leaf. The Spinococcus solanopsis is a sucking pest. It suck the plant sap. Okay, it's a hemipteran insect. It is commonly called as the cotton mealybug. Reported over 200 plants. The economic threshold level is damage of 40 to 60%. Then we will go for the pest management. Thymethoxam is a pesticide, neonicotinoid pesticide. Nicotinoid is a plant-based insect, biopesticides, but this is the synthetic insecticide. Thymethoxam is a synthetic insecticide. So this insecticide is incorporated into the cellulose nanocrystals, and we prepared the spears. We prepared the spears and tested against this Phenococcus solanopsis. And the mortality is, commercial product, this is the nanomaterials. So slightly different between the mortality of commercial product and this nanomaterials. These are another publications. This is our publication. So we prepared the nanomaterials, the silver nanomaterial by using Ananas squamosa, and Justica ada doda, Ipomoea carnea and Pongamia clara. So all the four plants has been utilized for the preparation of the AG silver nanoparticles. Here I have listed out these unpublished data, highlighted the LC50 value. So you can compare the LC. This is the mortality caused by the aqueous extract. This is the mortality caused by the nanomaterial. So this is about the Vijay Neem. The Vijay Neem, the recommended LC50 value is 0.848. So the red color indicates below the Neem value, below the Vijay Neem. Okay. So automatically we can recommend either the aqueous extract of these plants or the nanomaterials. So very, very low value is 0.011. prepared by using the Ananas squamosa. So we can utilize this kind of material for the Phenococcus solanopsis pest management. Another sucking pest is the Bemisia tabaci. It's a very worst pest. It is distributed in almost all the continent, Africa, Asia, Europe, and North America, almost all the continent. But a lot of the biotype is available. In different places, different biotypes are available. But the symptoms, damage level is almost the same in all the continent. And another importance of the Bemisia tabaci is it's a vector. It is not only act as a pest but also act as a vector. It is transmitting Behemo virus to the various plants. So one way it acts as a pest, another way it acts as a vector. So it causes very danger, very destruction, or very economic loss to the plants. So this kind of pest can be considered for the management. The economic threshold is, if you come across 5 to 10 white fly, you may come across these insects in your home garden also. So if you come across 5 to 10 Bemassia tabaci in a leaf, then it is recommended to go for the management. Cytosylum essential oil has been utilized for the preparation of the nanomaterial. The caprolactone is a polymer, biopolymer, lot of biopolymer has been utilized for the synthesis of the nanomaterials. So actually it's easy, emulsify oil concentration, they incorporated 2E80, they incorporated biopolymer, the solvents and the essential oil. So this essential oil, after preparation of the essential EC formulation, what they did is they incorporated into the encapsulation. So the advantage of encapsulation is it can be retained in the field for very long time. That's advantage of EC and the emulsifiable concentration. Okay, and another advantage is they are biocompatible, they are biodegradable, and they don't leave any toxicity like other nanomaterials. So this is the reduction level of after incorporating the encapsulation in the field level. The author recorded the egg of the white fly, and they also recorded the nymphs after 13th day and 16th day after introducing the encapsulation. So after introducing the encapsulation in the 3rd day and the 6th day, the nanomaterial incorporated field, the egg reduction is 96%, but in the oil it is only 97%, but there is no statistical significance between these comparing to the oil and the nano. However, it reduced a sumptuous number of eggs as well as the nymphs in the field situation. So it can be recommended for the management of Bemassia tabaci or the white fly. The encapsulation, the double strand RNA has been recommended for the encapsulation purpose. Termite population is reduced by using this encapsulation, RNA incorporated encapsulation. Spotoptera litoralis is reduced, Helicobacter armigera is reduced. What they do is two materials are incorporated. Say for example, the RNA and another one material is incorporated into the formulations. Say for example, the BT is incorporated into the RNA. So what the BTs do is they enter into the body and disturb the and causes the lesion in the midgut area. So it is very easy to incorporate or joining with the midgut area and causes the death of the organism by the DNAs. Similarly, I told you the cytochrome. The cytochrome enzyme also incorporated along with the double strand RNAs. So it causes more impact than if you incorporate only one product. The tribolium or the rice flour beetle also controlled by using this double strand RNAs incorporated encapsules. So this is the overall mechanism. Okay, the nanoparticles, they enter into the cell organelles like the mitochondria or the nucleus and causes the damage. This is one kind of mechanism proposed by many scientists. Another kind of mechanism is either it may be present into the DNA combined with the DNA molecules, or they are present present between two cells or the intercellular layer and causes the death of the cells. And if it is present on the surface of the cell, then it intervene with the cell permeability and cell functions and subsequently causes the cell death. It intervene with many enzymes. Particularly the acetylcholine esterase, it is very essential to transmit the impulses from one neuron to another neuron and also between the neuron to muscles. So accumulation of the acetylcholine esterase takes place, so it causes the death. This is one mechanism proposed, another mechanism proposed. And another mechanism is, and the nanoparticles intervene with the normal enzymes, hydrolytic enzymes, lipase, invertase, amylase, protease, like enzymes, and causes the intervene their pathways and causes the death. And it also intervene with the genes. It also intervene with the proteins. It also intervene with the protein molecules. So it intervene with the macromolecules. It intervene with the enzymes. It intervene with the cellular organelles. It intervene with the genes. Say for example, the gonadotropin releasing hormone genes, balbiana ring protein genes, and it stop the reproduction of the organisms. So it intervene with the macromolecule, it intervene with the enzymes, it intervene with the genes, it intervene with the organelles and causes the death. So these are the mechanisms through which the nanoparticle causes death into the insects. So in addition to the cultivable crab pest, it also applicable to manage the storage pests. Okay, so I highlight some few storage pests, starting with the Tribonium costianum. It's a coleopteran pest. It has the egg, larva, pupa and the adult. So it affect the grain products, dried foods and pet foods, dried flowers. When we store the products, all these products, you may come across a small brown colored beetles in your home. You may come across this beetle in your home. So it is a Tribonium costianum. So by weight loss, it causes 4.5% weight loss. But in addition to the weight loss, it also suppress the germination percentage. So it suppress 73% of this germination loss. Okay. So many chemicals, synthetic chemical has been utilized in a very low quantity because we are incorporating the chemicals into the consumable, human consumable product. So it is recommended to use it in a very low dose or very low percentage. Even then, this Tribonium costianum developed resistant against the synthetic chemicals. So the copper-based nanomaterial has been recommended. So the Pseudomonas fluorescens is one of the important pest management component, microbial insecticide. So it is cultured and the suspension, the liquid broth suspension has been utilized for the preparation of the copper based nanomaterials. So the once it is prepared and characterized, we confirm the liquid broth or the material consists of the nanomaterials, then we can utilize for the management. So the wheat grain is mixed with the liquid nanomaterials and dry it under the sun and under laboratory condition, the Tribonium costianum adults were incorporated into the copper nanomaterial treated wheat grains and recorded the mortality. So the mortality is 30% in the 24 hours, it increased to 67% and it increased to 100%. So within 72 hours, it causes the total mortality in the adult. But we are incorporating into the wheat, so we can take care of. So need a lot of research because we are incorporating the nanomaterial into the raw wheat. Some methodology can be devised to incorporate the nanomaterial into the wheat, okay, because it is consumable product. So it's only the laboratory results. Another pest is the Calasupricus maculatus, green gram, Bengal gram, pulses. Most of the pulses and beans, grams, are affected by this Calasupricus maculatus. In commonly, we can come across this pest in our home also. So it causes nearly 3% loss. So in addition, it also causes the germination. It also reduces the germination. This maculatus management, the Indian snake root has been recommended for the preparation of nickel oxide based nanomaterials. So once the nickel based Indian snake root nanomaterial is prepared, then it is mixed with the black gram seeds, dried in the sun for 3 to 4 hours, at least 2 to 3 hours per day. Then we have to incorporate the Calasupricus. We have to introduce the Calasupricus maculatus and find out the mortality and other aspects related to the pesticidal value. So in the control, the emergence is 22. Sorry, the developmental time is 22-23 days, but it prolonged when we incorporated the nickel-based nanomaterial. Similarly, the adult emergence is 83% in the control. It reduced in the nickel-based nanomaterials. Similarly, the fecundity is also reduced. So, however, you can take care of need further research, incorporation method needs. So, if the students are here, the research scholars are here, you can take care of this kind of research for your PhD program or MPhil program like that. Another important percentage is the Psittacillus oryzae. So the Psittacillus oryzae is a rice weevil, common pest in the rice. So this Amman pachersi, Euphorbia, already I introduced this plant, the Euphorbia. So Euphorbia based nanomaterial is prepared. Euphorbia based nanomaterial is prepared and utilized for this management. So this is a result. This is a result of the adult mortality caused by the Euphorbia based silver nanomaterial and the silver nano solution, Euphorbia based the product. Okay. So the last day, 35% mortality, and in the nano material, silver nano material cost only 32% mortality. So if you incorporate the Euphorbia with the nanomaterial, then it causes 100% mortality even in the 7th day. So this kind of result is very good results, but we have to take care of. So I have completed the defoliator pest management, sucking pest management, storage pest management. Now we will move into the phytopathogens. Because the infestations caused by the macroorganisms in the plant, infections caused by the microorganism in the plant, both infection and infestation causes the damage as well as the yield loss. So the microorganism can also be considered as a pest organism. So pest organism, insects alone cannot be considered as a pest organism. Microorganism and even the macro, the sheep, goat can also be considered as a pest. And the rice blast. So it causes three kind of infestation, infection in the rice. It infect the leaf, it infect the nodal region, it also infect the inflower, the grains. So in the, if it is infected with the grain is very poor quality, so it is not possible to consume. So if it is infect the nodal region, it is easily broken, so we will get the very great loss. It infect the leaf, the photosynthesis is reduced, so we will, the farmer get the reduction of loss. So this mold, Dr. Sakai Sadis is very familiar and doing a lot of research in the moss and the mold. So yesterday also he had a PhD bios of to his candidate. The mold, there are three kinds of molds are recommended for the preparation of the polylactic acid incorporated nanomaterial. Polylactic acid incorporated nanomaterials. So among the three mold, the growth is highly reduced by the elatum. The growth is highly reduced by the elatum. So in the next slide, I will show you spore production. So the spore, though the elatum is reduced the growth of the rice blast, the Brassicaceae is reduced the spore production. So it reduced the spore production 90%, 85%, 92% and 93%. So most the highest spore reduction was recorded in the exchange extract of the Brassicaceae. So this kind of plant, this kind of the mold can be recommended for the disease reduction in the rice. This is another important disease. Turicica is the important disease causing agent of maize. It also causes damage in the corn. It also causes damage in the corn. Most of the continent, Turicia is common in most of the continent. In India, considering India, it is common in the maize plant cultivable in Punjab, Maharashtra, Himachal Pradesh and Kashmir Valley. And the loss is ranging between 24 to 91%. This Turicica is a very worst infectious agent in the maize, corn. This can be managed by using the Lucidium leaf extract. Lucidium leaf extract. So this Lucidium leaf extract can be used as a stabilizing agent for the preparation of the silver nanoparticles. So after preparing the silver nanoparticles, the inhibition concentration is about 170 microgram per ml. So the very low concentration, it inhibited the growth of the Turicia in corn as well as in the maize. So the another suggestion is, so after the preparation of this silver based nanoparticle, it is incorporated with the epoxy nanosol, another important antifungal agent. So it further reduced in different proportion, 8:2 proportion and 9:1 proportion. So further it reduced the incident of the Turicia in maize and corn. At the apple, we come across lot of fungus. You may come across lot of fungus both in the leaf as well as in the fruit. So all the fungus can be reduced by using the eucalyptus based nanomaterial. And the zinc one millimolar zinc nitrate is prepared, and the reducing agent is the eucalyptus globus, and it is sprayed in the apple tree. So we may come across the reduction of the fungus, reduction of fungus in the apple, starting with 67 to 72%. Even zinc oxide is considered as one of the important fungicidal agent. It causes say 85% reduction, and the eucalyptus leaf extract alone reduced 79%. So this is our research. So the Xanthomonas malvaceorum is a very worst microbes causes damage in the cotton. So our research mainly focusing with the cotton, groundnut and other grams like plants in the cultivable in the local area. So in the cotton we may come across many lesions, leaf lesions, leaf spotted disease, and even it affects the bolls of the cotton. So when we incorporate the nanomaterial and spray it under the field condition, we had field work, controlled field gauge work as well as the field work. So I have not highlighted the field work in the presentation. So the laboratory results and the controlled field gauge results shows and the nanomaterial shows lot of structural changes. It inhibits this spore germination. It causes a swelling, dumbbell shaped swelling. So it causes budding. Budding occurs in the apex or the middle of the hyphae. It also causes the intercellular leakage. So these are the simple mechanism we observed under the light, under the microscopic observations. Maybe the reasons. I also highlight another reasons in the end of this slide. The minimum incubatory concentration of the six seaweeds based nanomaterials, Padania pavanica, highly reduce the growth of the Xanthomonas malvaceorum followed by the Sargassum whitey. Least impact was observed in the Callalpa perulensis. We also observed the spore germination. So growth is important. Spore production is also important. So observation of the growth, observation of the spore germination is very vital when we do any research related to the fungus and other microorganisms. So various concentration of the various seaweed based nanomaterials are incorporated into the Xanthomonas malvaceorum and recorded the spore germination. So it is a dose dependent one. From 10 microgram per milliliter to 160. So it's a dose dependent one. Again, the Padania pavanica also reduced the spore germination, and the least impact was recorded in the Callalpa scapuliformis. So this is another mechanism followed by the nanomaterials. So when we incorporate the nanomaterial into the culture medium of the Xanthomonas malvaceorum, we come across this is a very good bioassay used to denote the impact of the nanomaterial against the Xanthomonas malvaceorum. So the what it do is the sugar, cytoplasmic sugar reduction. It's a very good bioassay. We may carry it out by one of the scholar, Dr. Rajesh. Now he is working in Israel. So there is a very good indication of the impact of the nanomaterial against the bio nanomaterials. So in addition to the spore germination, in addition to the gonadial the growth, he also recorded the simple mechanism through which the nanomaterial causes the damage to the Xanthomonas malvaceorum. So we had some experiment in the field level. We prepared the nano formulations. It is called as the Kalpa. So in the introduction, Dr. Sagai Sadesh told that there are two patent right. So one of the patent right is the Kalpa. Formulated the formulation, fungal formulation. It also can be utilized for the pesticide. So it's a Callalpa based biopesticide. It is called as the Kalpa. So in the Kalpa, emulsifiable concentration reduce the seed germination. And the Callalpa varolensis based the nanomaterial reduced higher seed germination reduction. Okay. We also had the plot, micro plot studies. The study shows the Kalapa virulensis, Kalapa scapuliformis based nanomaterial. They increase the production on the bowl, cotton bowl, about 1.17 kilogram cotton per 30 plants. It also increased when the Kalapa scapuliformis based nanomaterials are sprayed under the field condition. So this is the micro plot we have been utilizing for various study purposes. Few publications starting with the bio nanoparticles for synthesis and microbial application. This is the Padania Pavanica publication. This is the Sandomonas publications. This is another publication related to the Terminalia chavla, silver nano based nanomaterials and its anti phytopathogenic activity. It's a review paper published. This is another paper, Pericalia Rasinia. I have already highlighted about this paper. So we also had one publication where we incorporated the monocrotopus and the neem pesticides, neem pesticide, and recorded the pest management practice. We got a very good results. So instead of using the monocrotopus is a very most chemical insecticide, has been recommended by many people. So it has lot of side effects. So instead of using the monocrotopus, if you incorporated the biopesticide like the neem, we may reduce the pesticide load in the field level and also get very good results. So these are some of our publications related to the nanomaterial. We had nearly 14 publications. So thank you so much for the patient listening. The questions are most welcome. Questions, clarifications.
Thank you, Dr. Now the session is open for discussion. Sir, we have a few questions
tell me, ma'am.
Posted in the chat box. The first tell question me, ma'am. Is, how do bio nanomaterials help in controlling pests in mushroom cultivation?
I don't have any idea related to this question. My main idea is cultivable crops. I don't have any answer for this question, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Thank you. The second question is, can we prepare bio nanomaterials using Azadirachta indica crude extract?
Yes, we can prepare. There are a lot of publications, more than 100 publications are available related to the crude extract of Azadirachta indica, preparing the silver nanomaterial, gold nanomaterial, palladium nanomaterial, zinc nanomaterial, copper nanomaterial. Enormous publication, more than 100 publications are available in the literature. You can easily prepare.
Hello.
Sir, another question. Whether any changes in physiological, biochemical, and yield parameters of a plant was noted if treated with nanoparticles?
So actually, there is not much publications are available related to the physiological impact or the in the phyto impact of the nanomaterials. If you use the nanomaterials in very high concentrations, then automatically it causes the necrosis-like symptoms.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Hello ma'am.
Welcome, participants. Ma'am. Sir.
I am Satish, ma'am. Shall I ask
a question? Yeah, sure, sir.
Hello.
Tell me, sir. Tell me, sir.
Presentation is wonderful and very clear.
And thank you so much, sir.
Basic doubt, because I am working in nano particle synthesis. My PhD scholars have done and awarded 1 degree, sir. One basic doubt, sir.
Tell me.
For example, sir. Silver nitrate nanoparticle synthesis with the plant extract, the simple method to synthesis is the stock solution of silver nitrate and the plant extract. And some researchers are keeping in the sunlight for the plasmon resonance, to the incorporation of the amalgamation of the silver nitrate, silver with the phytocommons, the plant extract. But some researchers, they won't keeping in the, without keeping in the sunlight, the dark itself, they got the color change. What you followed?
We followed natural way, sir, without keeping it in the sunlight, in the laboratory condition. Under laboratory condition, we added the plant extract in different quantity, and at last we find out the synthesis, sir. So the natural synthesis, they are saying that it is natural synthesis, that's why they are keeping it in the sunlight, sir. It's a added advantage for their publication. It is synthesis naturally under the sunlight, because some kind of particles can be utilized for the this third generation solar light. Okay, if it is prepared by using the under solar light, then that can be utilized for the solar light material preparation, sir. That's why they are keeping it in this under the sunlight.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions from participants side?
Madam, how many participants, ma'am?
Sir, nearly 70, sir.
Okay, okay.
Sir, I have a question, sir. Can I ask?
Tell me, sir. Yeah.
If we go for the foliar spray of nanoparticles, did you observe any toxic effect on the plants, sir?
No, ma'am. If you use it in a very low quantity, as already specified in the PPM, no, 50 ppm up to 100, 500 ppm, we don't observe any changes in the plant.
Okay, sir. Sir, what about the bioavailability in plants, sir? For example, if you are using the zinc nanomaterials, if you go for foliar spray of zinc nanomaterials, what about the bioavailability of zinc in the plants?
Tell me, ma'am.
Because we are applying the silver nanomaterials and the zinc, so on, so that is the metal nanomaterials. So all are toxic if it exceed the level. So what about the bioavailability?
So you, while we are applying in this spray, foliar spray, I told you only 1% is falling on the plant. Nearly 99% of the foliar spray is falling on the ground only. When the watering or the irrigation takes place, most of the times in the plant absorb the minerals and other materials, and the remaining materials are falling, they wash away into the water system.
Okay, sir, thank you. Then what about the toxic effects if it enters into the soil? What about the microbes in the soil, sir? Does it have any toxic effects on the soil?
We had one experiment about the number of the colony farming unit only. We had some observation, only number of colony farming unit. There is not much difference between the normal and the, as well as the nanomaterial treated field. But there are lot of the so ma'am, it is reflecting, ma'am.
Yes sir.
If it is going beyond the particular level, after I have mentioned, if it is going beyond the particular concentration,
So the zinc is one of the important minerals. Zinc is one of the important. Zinc is one of the important minerals essential for the plant growth and the fruiting. Yeah. So whatever the possible way, it may be absorbed. Otherwise, it will not absorb too much amount of zinc from the soil. Okay. Even if it is absorbed, it may be accumulated. Say for example, the ficus. If it is absorbing more amount of the calcium like that, it may be deposited into the plant. I had some the practicals when I teach in St. Joseph's College to the BSc students, having the cross section of the ficus plant and observe the lot of calcium like the ions in the leaf. Such a kind of modification maybe takes place in the plant.
Sir, another question, sir. How to control beetles in coconut cultivation for young coconut saplings?
Actually, the coconut pest can be controlled by the root feeding. We have to prepare the solution. We have to prepare the solution and keep it in the plastic bag. And we have to keep it in the root. Remove the root cap and keep the solution into the root cap. And you got a knot, bake a knot. Within 1 or 2 days, it may be entered into the plant through this. This is the only method mainly adapted by the entomologist to manage the coconut pests. Okay. Root feeding, that is called it as the root feeding.
Okay, thank you. So another question, do you suggest any cofactor with extract for plant application which will be effective? That means they are asking which concentration is effective for plants.
I am not having an idea, ma'am, cofactor.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any participants, any other questions? You can post your questions in the chat box. We have nearly totally 100 participants.
Thank you so much. So it is showing only 9 participants. That's why I am asking about.
No, that is in EZ Talk, sir. But the YouTube live streaming is going on. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So
okay,
there
okay,
we have
okay.
Nearly 90 participants, sir.
Okay. Any clarifications?
There's no questions.
And then thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to interact with you, the botanists, as well as the faculty, students, research scholar from many institutions in and around the Tamil Nadu and the various states. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Gratitude is the inward feeling of kindness received. Thankfulness is the natural impulse to express that feeling. Thanksgiving is the following of that impulse, says Von Dyke. First of all, I'd like to thank the Lord Almighty for making this session a successful one. On behalf of Botany Department, I express my sincere thanks to Dr. Sahaya Raj, Associate Professor of Zoology, St. Xavier's College, Palayamkottai. You have wonderfully and clearly explained the strategies using nanotechnology for pest management, sir. Your session is very informative. Thank you, sir. We are grateful to the Head Department of Botany and the Dean School of Biological Sciences for their constant support and encouragement towards this webinar. I express my sincere thanks to Dr. Kanike Raj, sir. Associate Professor of Physics for the technical support to this webinar. Last but not least, I thank the participant friends for their patience and the support shown to us in this session. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Ma'am, hello.
Sir?
Announce tomorrow's event.
Okay, sir. Dear participants, we have two more sessions on tomorrow. That is, one session is by morning 9 o'clock, and the second session is at 4 o'clock tomorrow evening. So we look forward for your active participation in tomorrow's session also. Thank you. Dear participants, kindly fill the feedback link which is posted in the chat box. Thank you. Because the separate feedback link will be given tomorrow's session, so please kindly fill the feedback link for the today's session. Thank you.
Dr. Sagaraj, hello, 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 can you
sir,
hear me?
Sir, he's not here, sir. He's not here, sir. Yeah, okay.
I will call him right away. Thank you, ma'am. Bye.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Bye. Thank you.